Every thought is filtered through a lens from a camera that no one can see. I can feel its inner parts churning out machines. We have to defeat this. Inside, outside, what will it matter when all these forces come down? Inside, outside, what will it matter if we passively agree to do nothing? If we choose to do nothing.
Aka, Midori, Ao, Gunjoiro, Kyudei.
Imagine wo shigeki suru kara haibai.
Nice mutual blue.
Hey, where's everybody's
Sayonara?
Oh, you want one?
There's got to be a song called Little Blue Rose.
Oh, really?
Yeah, that's right.
Look pretty cool.
Oh, wow.
Well, I can order kids with them on that.
They got one.
The handyman in here.
Which handyman?
You get one?
I am going to get a real one.
So we had our first fatal flaw there, but it's all coming. So, hi. Hi, everyone. Welcome. Welcome to stream number 10072022. And I wasn't joking. I was trying not to write anything today. In fact, I've been trying all week not to write anything. And I'm in this weird, like, I don't know, spacey interplanetary thing going on. I don't know. I don't know what it is. But, right? That would be funny, Robert. So just so you know that I'm not joking. So right before the stream, all I had planned was that Andy was going to start it all off. And after the Andy bit, I was going to come in, say hi to everyone, and go right into it. I wasn't planning to write anything. But so you know that it's not, I'm not joking. I literally was writing those lyrics like about 10 minutes before the thing. So anyone who says I don't give you previews of things to come, well, they're lying, aren't they? So hello, everyone. And it's going to be a strange but kind of cool evening. So I'm going to lay it all out. This is an old show. I played some of this before when we were in Quarantstream. And I think that when we played it, I may have played it from the DVD player. And I think how I did it was I had it in the DVD player because I had this transferred. And I played them in a very raw state. I don't think they sound anything like they're going to sound tonight. I have taken these, cut them, cleaned them, made them sound, to my ears, presentable as it can be. So much so that tonight's collectible, tonight's NFT, as it were, is an actual mixtape of everything you're going to hear tonight. So it's like a double whammy of stuff tonight, but I'm getting ahead. So yeah, what you saw was some backstage stuff, which is I was getting a fake tattoo on my arm, and I think we all got them that day. And that was behind the scenes of this MTV festival that happened in 1992. In trying to remember all the details of this event, the only thing I can tell you is that I believe this is post-Berlin, but in the writing phase of the Hope album. So that's the time period that we're going to. And in this particular case, I really love the way these turned out, but that's me, that's my opinion. Of course, it doesn't mean anything. What matters is what you guys think of it when it's all said and done, right? So, topics open while we're, you know, while we watch, we can talk. And of course, if you've got any questions for me, ask. But I think we're going to start because it's an interesting thing because when I think back, to the stuff we were doing then compared to now, or compared to all the different phases that we've been in, it's a crazy journey. And it's a journey that I needed to take this week, especially because I was going through a little bit of weirdness with my creativity. We'll get into it, but lots to get into, I think. Oh, wait. I wrote all this stuff on the back of this flyer. So just so you can see, I think you can see. Let's see. Let's see if I can make this work. You may or may not hear all of the above. I guess one of them's out of the bag. I guess two of them's out of the bag. There was no WEF song, but I guess that happened somehow. Anyway, resist. But, like I said, feel free to ask me questions. It's all good. Questions are welcome. Anyway, further ado.
done. Now we play an intro and make believe you never saw us before. And we just come on and stage for the first time.
Okay.
See you guys later.
Dressed.
She's getting dressed
over there. 1 minute.
Don't be nervous. Hurry up. Hurry up. Hurry up. Don't be nervous. Hurry up.
Stop.
Hey, my name is Scott Spice for 104 KRDE.
Thank you.
So much to talk about right there. Oh, those shorts. Oh my God. Yeah, I don't know that I could pull them off now. I just wouldn't be able to pull. I wouldn't feel comfortable. I couldn't do it. Oh, I'd love to go to Chicago, but for some reason, well, I don't. There's a huge reason why this is happening, but yeah, shows are just. I think what's coming up next is El Paso and San Antonio. I'm gonna make those official on Monday, even though there is a flyer for one of them already. But yeah, I'm coming to El Paso and San Antonio in November. Yeah, Chicago didn't happen this year the way I wanted it to. Who knows? But one never knows. It could happen in December or something, but nothing is yet. But I have to kind of, you know, see where that goes. I'm reading your chats. That's what throws me off. I start reading the chats and then I'm like, I lose my place. So no, interwebs are okay. Unless of course you're on Facebook. Facebook tends to cut off songs if it triggers their, algos. So if you're listening and you want to get the best listening experience, it is on YouTube. Although I heard that Twitter and Twitch are actually not too bad, but the best is on YouTube. Just letting you know. You know, I'm not trying to, it's not like I'm trying to, tell you to subscribe or anything like that, you know, like the little thing underneath my voice there. But no, it genuinely sounds the best on YouTube. I'm not joking. It does. So, Bill's asking me, was this right after recording Worth? I think it is. I think this is us coming back from Germany and then slowly starting the tour thing. Because Life is Fun was written, well, I'm giving it away, but one of the songs in the set was written after Worth, so obviously we had finished it. But we did not know, of course, if it was coming out. So this is in the middle of all the turmoil between us and Sony, which was an interesting thing because now that I'm trying to remember it, one of the things that happened was that we almost didn't get to play this MTV Festival because technically we weren't signed. We had just ended our relationship with Sony, and that sort of excluded us from this gig, which is really interesting, right? That, you know. But I don't know if I have. No, I don't think I do. I don't think I have that shirt. It was a turtleneck, I think. There's a lot of the old ones that I wish I still had that I don't have, but this is not one of them. I don't know. I don't know what I'm saying. I'm looking at the chats. I'm looking at a million questions, but yes. So there was to answer a question up there, Lalo and I were talking about, the Lima show, and yeah, there is a Lima show that I do have on DVD. But the problem with the DVD ones is they're not direct transfers. They're in weird formats. They're on DVDs, but they're not even video files or normal video files. So I have to go through it, but I know I have one of the Lima shows, or at least parts of it. So that's one that I would love to work on next. So maybe by next Friday, that's the other one that's on my radar. Unless I find something crazier in, not that you can see it, but as you can see, I've been opening up VHSs and popping them in and trying to find gems. So there are a few that I'd like to get in there before the year's out. It would be nice. Especially because the shows in Lima were really cool. So I definitely would like to have some of those get them on this thing archived so that they're there and, you know, what have you. But so anyway, yes, that was Kiss of Love, 1992 MTV Festival. You're going to see the entire thing, basically. So we're just going to go right through it. So it's interesting, too, because we usually don't open with Kiss of Love. Very rare that we would open with that song. It's usually a song we kind of save for the end. And I was surprised at the order of these songs, quite frankly. So Lalo saying the one with Moenia. Yeah, I don't know that Moenia is in the one that I have. I mean, what I have is just us playing, but I think he makes a cameo. I'm not sure. I'm not sure that's the one I have, but, you know, I have one of them, and I'm going to have to, like, dig it out and, you know, get it transferred and put it on the official, you know. So, yeah. I mean, I wish I had I didn't have my really fancy cameras back then, but I wish I did, because there was some really cool stuff that happened on that show that would have been awesome to have on film. Like us and the guys from Moenia singing Depeche Mode songs to the audience below from the building. We were on the second floor and we were singing to them. And we asked them what song they wanted to hear. And someone said, "Just Can't Get Enough." So we looked at each other like, "Really?" So we said, "Okay." So that would be funny. But anyway, moving right along, I'm going to play you the second song in this thing. But before I do, I'm going to reveal something. I'm going to make this live, by the way. The minute that this thing's over, at some point during the week, I will post every single video as its own video because I planned it that way. But tonight's collectible, let's turn on the chat thing so you can see what I'm talking about. The collectible for the evening is my first ever true audio NFT. That's right. The entire show as a mixtape on Tezos. That's like an exclusive. I've never done that before. I think it's going to be fun. So I wanted to try something using, you know, the blockchain and audio. So that's the start of something. And anyone, I'm telling you right now, anyone who collects this piece, well, let me put it to you this way. If you help me out and you collect it, things will go come your way that you didn't expect. But that's the only way. Because right now you can listen to it for free. I think you could even download it for free. So no one's stopping you. But if you collect it as an NFT, it comes with things that you will not get unless you collect it. I'm gonna keep a hard line on this one. This is not going on Bandcamp. It's not going to go anywhere else. It's staying right where it is. So I'm just letting you know. Anyway, let's move on. Next song. Oops.
This next song is called Our Dreams. We're doing some oldies first.
You guys mind?
No! Cool.
Thank you.
Sorry, I have to keep switching back and forth. You can hear it fine, right? I know that it skips a few times, but that has to do with the interwebs. More reason to, you know, watch the videos when I post them finally. They'll go up on YouTube. Like I said, throughout the week, I'll be posting all of them on YouTube as a playlist. And here's the link to the NFT part. It's not live yet. You can listen to it. You can download it. You just can't collect it. I'm going to make it as a collectible by the end of the next song. And if you were here last week, you're going to kind of know the significance of this, but I'm only making, of the collectibles, there's only 369 of them. 369. So, like I said, you can follow that link. You can listen to it for free when you have time. You can probably download it without needing a wallet or anything, which is fine. It's considered like a free gift. But if you collect it, if you actually collect it, there are things that will come with it that you cannot get if you just download it. There are things that will happen. I promise you. So. But anyway. So, obviously, I'm not immune to the news. I heard that Depeche Mode is going to tour and they got a new album that they're working on. I saw some snippets. Did you guys get to hear that stuff? I got to hear part of one song and it sounded okay. I was kind of happy. I was like, man, I hope they don't tour in the same city I'm in because then I'm hosed. Right? Think about myself. But anyway, but it's true. But they are touring, but it's interesting because there's only 6 dates in North America for the moment. I have a feeling that they're going to add more dates. I heard it from a little bird that there will be more dates probably added. I'm hoping I can, but I just don't know that I'm going to pay $5,000 for a ticket. And I've seen some that were that high. So I was like, what? Yeah, I don't know. I don't know that I would do that, especially at this moment in time. But anyway, I was going to tell you what happened this week because, you know, you want to know all about my life and the inner workings of whatever the heck is going on back here. But, so this week I had a sort of weird creative catharsis where I found myself writing, which is not a terrible thing, by the way. Writing is a good thing. And this is the lesson here. Whenever you get a writing spurt, even if you're in the middle of other projects, it's okay to follow the muse. Although sometimes it'll feel more like you're bending towards some sort of resistance because you're like, man, I'm almost done with this one record. Why am I stopping all the work on this to, you know, write new material? Why am I focusing on sound? You know, what is happening to me? Am I really done with this record? Like, you know, like all these weird things happened to me this week where everything seemed to clash. And then, as happens when these sorts of things occur, it coalesced into a total, complete meltdown of nothing. Like, nothing's happening. I'm writing, but it's just mindless. So I was kind of upset, but a lot of it has to do with scheduling and just kind of getting used to a new schedule. In a funny way, some newfound time in the studio, which I'm learning to make it work now, but it's taken me a week and a half for it to get there. But I think the most that I got out of this week was checking in on these videos, because at least it forced me to hunker down, and I worked really hard on them. You may not think so, but I did, because it was a lot to fix, a lot to unpack. Oh, another interesting tidbit I didn't tell you. Thank you, Wendy, for helping everyone out. So we used to use backing tracks to play some of these shows, well, a lot of them. We still do. But these backing tracks, the tracks that we would use would come off of digital audio tape. So rather than take a sequencer on stage, we would take a DAT machine, and the DAT machine would play back whatever it was we wanted, to have on the track. So in digging up this 1992 thing, I found that I still had that DAT and I had transferred it. So I was able to take all the backing tracks from the old DAT and try to sync them up to this video so that I could kind of fix things, which is good because it means I could match up certain pieces of audio. Didn't always work correctly or the right way that I wanted it to work. And there was sometimes when I thought I was going to have to give it up because, for example, if the tracking on the VCR was not quite right, you might get a slippage of time and that would make everything kind of fail. I did run into this. I believe, is it on the next song? No, I don't think it's on the next song. I think it's on, it's two songs coming where kind of, but well, you should collect it, Robert. It's the two little or the three little dots next to the play thing. It says download. Unless, of course, you have to have an account on Object, but oh well. We'll have to see how that works. No, you don't have to because I just tried it. It worked for me and I'm not logged into it. So yeah, we'll keep forwarding the link. But anyway, so getting these transferred and fixing them up was very difficult and it required some discipline because I don't know if you're familiar with video rendering, but it takes a long time. In my case, I'm lucky that my computer is actually pretty darn fast. And at best, each video took about 15 to 20 minutes to render. And luckily, there were no mistakes so that I didn't have to do it again, because usually, So anyway, but sorry, I see all the questions flying in about the Tezos things, which is awesome. Thank you. I have the Temple wallet and I quite like it. That's the one I've been using. There are different ones, but that's the one I've been using personally and I'm really happy with it. It's quick, it's easy, it's super easy to set up. I would definitely read up on, at least acquiring Tezos. I would read up on making sure that you don't throw away your password or your secret phrase because those are irrecoverable. So make sure that you write them down in a really good place. I have mine written down in like five different places because I really care a lot about this stuff. So anyway, so without further ado, let's play another video and I'll make the thing live. And let's see. Who's
This
next?
next song is called
Oh,
Our
no, we
Dream.
saw that one. Here we go.
Hot today, huh?
It's hotter up here.
All right, guys, you're ready to dance today. You're gonna promise me you're gonna move those bodies now?
Let me see you sweat.
All right, let me see you sweat. This is called When We Lie. Let's have some fun today, okay?
Thank you.
So funny. To me, that's so funny, man. It's weird watching your younger self. Man, I'm feeling that age now. I'm like, man, I can't wear those shorts anymore. I wouldn't want to, but at the same time, it's like, I don't know. It worked then. I don't know. It's strange. It's so strange. So Jason Smith on Facebook is asking me, maybe you covered this at some point. I seem to remember you had Claude S. after as a pseudonym for a few moments. The meaning? Actually, no. No, Claude S. is actually me. The problem is that no one could really spell... Okay, so let's back up. Most people that do what I do will change their name and have a pseudonym that they use to get paid. But in real life, their name is very different. It's actually a real thing. But I always just use my normal name. But my given name is Claudio Strilio. And almost no one can spell my last name correctly, nor can they spell it correctly. So it was easier to just put Claude S. And I thought, well, that's also a good way to hide my last name so that everyone just knows me as Claude S. And therefore, I'm not searchable. Even though back then there was no internet. But for some reason, I must have foreseen that there would have been a day where privacy might be an issue. So, and it's actually, it wound up being true because at some point in 1991, I would find strange things in my mailbox that someone had left in my mailbox. And obviously, they had found my address. So I kind of kept the S period for a while. And now I've got it all weird. Now it's just N-pop. So it's even weirder. But Claude S is fine. And I still use it. Of course. I am Claude S. But I hope that answers your question. So the NFT went live. So yes, when this is all over, I would collect it if I were you and you have some Tezos. You only need two. It's the equivalent of buying me a cup of coffee, believe it or not. And I do appreciate it, of course. But the idea of collecting it is that it is going to give you future gifts. I had earlier during the week on Tuesday, I had unleashed a different collectible that I've been waiting for it to be collected so that I could test this other thing out. And I confirmed it worked. So now that I know this, basically, for those that are new to the space, I'm going to explain it or try in my weird, messed up way. But let's say you get a collectible and you collect this NFT. I can come back later and add things to it. So to anyone who owns it, they could log into a certain thing and see that they now have an extra gift in there that's only for them. And I can randomly drop things into wallets that have collected my stuff. So that means that if I find some weird song and I decide to give it to everybody that's collected this particular piece, I would send it directly to them. And that's not the same, of course, if you just stream something or if you just download it. So it's just like getting extra gifts. But the big deal, I want you to know, that the big deal is that these things stay on the internet for as long as there will be an internet. And that means that the legacy lives on. And for me, that's more important than anything else. So take it with a grain of salt. I'm still going to make things that I put on Bandcamp, of course. But this is a worthwhile experiment. And I'm definitely going in this direction. So, and it's cheap. What can I say? It's a mixtape. So I would definitely take a listen. Hint, new album will have a lot of that. And you're going to want that stuff. I'm telling you. Just trust me. Trust me on it. I'm not stopping. But anyway, what did we listen to? Oh, that was When We Lie.
Ooh, I need water.
Or tea, as it were. when I get nervous, I start bringing in accents. Ah, why am I nervous? Yeah, Steve, that's funny. You're right. Gary also used to go under Gary S. for the same reason. And Denise, I'm glad you're on, Denise. Hi, by the way. Keep an eye out because you're going to see yourself. And I was quite surprised. So keep an eye out. You're going to see yourself in some of these. It's amazing how much time has passed for all of us. It just is. It's an amazing thing, actually, to go back and watch these. It was difficult to try to do the work on these things and not judge them, because that's hard. Because it's very easy to go, oh my God, I'm not gonna play this tonight. Blah blah blah. You know, no, this is embarrassing. This is a different time. I'm so not this person anymore. And you know, all these different emotions come up. But the reality of it is, I am still that kid. That kid is in there somewhere. And so anyway, I digress. Let's play the next song. Oh, yeah. Okay, so this is weird. So we started the set off with Kiss of Love. So this is going in the order that we played it. So the set starts off with Kiss of Love. Then it goes into Our Dreams. Then When We Lie. And then this song. And I was like, why is this song the fourth song? This doesn't make any sense. I had to kind of do a double take on it, but indeed it is. It is the fourth song. So either A, that was supposed to be the last song, and we planned it that way, or we came back and did encores. But I don't think that's what happened, because the way the video plays, it looks like we just stayed on stage. So for whatever reason, this is the fourth song. I know you're ready for this too.
This is called Living in Oblivion.
We'll be right back.
funny. So, you know, Robert, that's a really funny question. Can you tell us a little bit about the snare sound for this track? So this is interesting because that snare that is in this version of the song and is indeed a version of the snare that then does appear on the album. It's kind of like a variation of the same snare. It actually comes from Josh Fries. It's look him up. It's his snare. He had done some stuff for Stacey Q. And I just remember grabbing that snare and I was like, I'm going to take that. And we sampled it. So yeah, that snare on that version belongs to Josh Fries. So look him up. It's his snare, and the on the album, it's his kick too. He was a session drummer. And I must say, he's like one of the most sought after drummers in the world now. I believe he's in Tool right now, if I'm not mistaken. But yeah, that's Josh's snare. And I got to meet him once. He was a really nice guy. Even funnier is he also had a pad that we wound up keeping somehow, which is interesting, but another story for another day. But yeah, that's where that snare comes from. So thank you, Max. Thank you, all of you. Thank you so much for that. Yeah, that's so awesome. I love your comments, by the way. I'm trying to read them all as I, you know, scroll up, but then I get very distracted. But anyway, so this one was a fun one to work on because I had recently set up a few things on the computer to do more video editing, and the setup for everything in this room, I'm going to back out so you can see it. I think you'll be able to see it from here, but we'll see. Okay. So I can talk and you guys can follow along here. So this area in front of me, this area right here, is what I consider my writing area. So I've got my keyboards, you know, my machine, everything that I need to do to trigger or do anything happens on this side. Here is a controller section. So I have my controller, and usually I have another controller over here. But underneath this little table is now the VCR so that I can transfer tapes. And underneath in my rack, I also have a tape deck and a couple other things that I might need in case I need to do recording of vocals and so forth. But it's right now a one place does all, and it's not always that simple because I always have to, you know, like swap out microphones, or, you know, the setup isn't as good for video editing when I need it to be. So it kind of gets a little bit, it can get a little bit hairy trying to get everything organized in this room. So it's quite a bit of a mess right now. So, that's funny. I don't know what that means, but that is funny. So, it hasn't been easy to go from one thing to the next. And so mastering, usually when I set up for mastering in this room, I clear out the room because I want it to be as empty as possible. I want to have like a whole different set of headphones that I use, different pairs, a bunch of different devices that I go through. And I even wire things up a little bit different below in the rack. So that's due. And I need to do it this week. Oh, no, there's nothing to hear, Robert. You won't hear anything. You're just going to hear like a bunch of just random noise. There's not much that you're going to get out of it. but I'll pass it along to you, Robert. But So, yeah, if you're going to do, well, tell you what, David, I'm going to make it easier for you. So, DM me, if you can, your Tezos wallet. All right. DM it to me. I will pass you something so you can try it to see what it's like. Well, I guess it's going to turn into a tutorial on buying Tezos. I wish I could cue the music for this, but this is how it works. I understand, Robert. So this is how it works. I would not buy Tezos from the wallet itself. I would probably get a Coinbase account, do it there, because then you can buy like $5 worth of Tezos and send it over to your Temple wallet. And these are good things to try out anyway, because it's going to kind of get you started in crypto. And that's kind of like, yeah, see, like Wendy's got it right. She gets hers on Coinbase. And then once you start getting stuff on, and Coinbase is cool because you can buy like $5 worth if you want. You don't have to, you know, do $25 worth of Tezos using MoonPay and all that other stuff. It's not that I don't trust that stuff. It works. I just don't think you need to. So I prefer to get my Tezos on Coinbase. You know, it's simple. You spend $5, you get $5, you send it over to your Temple wallet, you're done. If you're new to Tezos, that's how I would do it. Jose's got a nice question. Yeah, don't use MoonPay. You just use Coinbase. It's so much easier. And you'll be able to get into other crypto. You'll be able to buy your first Bitcoin, which will make me a very proud person if you do. So there you go. Yeah. Coinbase or FTX, one of those. It's the easiest. But DM me. If it doesn't work, if all that doesn't work, just DM me. I'll figure something out for you. Preferably, if you can, DM me on Twitter. If you have an account on Twitter, that's the best place to reach me. But if not, you know. Yeah, there you go. I do the same thing, Wendy. I do that every time. And then I've collected quite a few things, and I tend to keep some Tezos in my wallet just in case. But I am a collector as well. I do collect the NFTs, by the way. I don't just make them. I love collecting them too. There's some amazing art on Tezos. There are some amazing, amazing digital art. And some of it someday could have an amazing, amazing value. And I'm not just talking about the Anything Box stuff or, you know, my own things. I'm talking about there are some amazing artists on that platform. And it's a wonderful community. I love them. I love all the weirdos on Tezos. So a quick shout out to my Tezos peers, because it's a new world for me too, and I'm loving every minute of it. It's been a fun 2 years for me. So, oh, of course, I've heard of Scent. I'm on Scent. So absolutely. So let's move along, because I think there's only well. So here's the songs we're not going to play. Here's the things we're not going to play. And I think you kind of knew this. We're not playing Jane Fonda. And we're not playing Santana. Okay? We're not. We're just not. I kind of put that in there to kind of fool you. But you did see that I did play Andy Warhol, right? You saw Andy. You'll see him again. I have uses for Andy still, but I digress. When I come back, we'll talk more, but here we go.
Here we go!
So funny, man. So me going to the side and talking to them like that, it's when I'm whispering stuff in their ear like, we have to skip this next song, whatever it is, or I don't know that we could do it or whatever. And then, you know, we would have our little fake arguments right there. And then it would be like, no, we're doing it. Oh man, do we have to? Yes. Okay. that's what that was. Me probably trying to get out of the next song, or something. I don't know. So, Jose G had a good question. So, did you guys see yourselves as a club band or a pop group? I mean, you play a lot of clubs and living in Oblivion 12-inch and all that. Well, okay. So we were always an electronic band. So that was first and foremost what we are. That's what Anything Box is. It's an electronic project. And it's actually a really strange experimental project. Go to Bandcamp and listen to the early stuff and then you'll understand. But like all bands that do this, like a really good example of what happened to us is very similar to what happened to OMD. If you listen to OMD's first two albums, they're really strange. They're really what I consider to be classic electronic music records. They're very strange, very off-kilter. The sound choices are just otherworldly. I would say the same about Human League, and I am now going to say the same thing about Heaven 17, which I saw last weekend, by the way. They were great. But in all those cases, like if you listen to the very first Human League album, they are very not pop. And then they got a hit. And then once you have the hit, you kind of get roped into, I'm going to do more songs like this because this is what the crowd likes. And you kind of work in that field, so to speak. But do I consider myself to be in a pop group? The answer to that question is probably no. But I love catchy melodies and I love things that you can remember. And I grew up on the Beatles, which is a total pop group, but I also love the experimental side of things. So I do not consider Anything Box to be a club band at all. Never have. And I don't typically consider us to be a pop thing either. But we can delve into it, just like I would say we're not a rave band or a techno band, but we delve into anything and everything. Man, if you would have heard the song I was working on like yesterday, you would think I was into metal. Like I was doing some crazy stuff yesterday, man. Yesterday and this afternoon. Crazy stuff. So it changes, you know, it depends. It depends on your mood, on the state of the world, the way you're processing information, the way, you know, the way you're feeling, the way things are unfolding in life. They will have an impact on how you write things. And sometimes it can sound really poppy. I think in the late 80s, we were really happy because we were getting a lot of gigs and, you know, a lot of people were attending and a lot of jumping around. So it was like, yeah, let's just keep writing catchy songs because that worked. But then once we'd done that, then it was like, well, we want to write something more on the moody side, hence Worth. I would not consider Worth to be a club record. Electrodelica, that for sure is not a club record, you know, but it changes. So my answer is that we are an electronic band, you know, or an electronic project, I would say. An art group. That's what we are. An art group of one person now, but yeah, an art group. So jubilation. So that mix was also not the typical one. That's not the one that I do now. The one that I do now actually is closer to the album version with a little bit of rave music thrown in, like old school, like more on the industrial-ish house side. This version was definitely more on the, you know, new wave synth pop thing. So this version, we don't really play that much anymore. We kind of redid it, and I love the new version. So I tend to favor that one. So unlike Living in Oblivion, this one, that version doesn't quite make it. But hey, one never knows. One never knows. So let's see. Yeah, we're not listening to Santana or Jane Fonda. That was just a joke. Don't request it. It's not happening. No WEF either. Resist. You must resist. But those are my subliminal messages. Resist. You must resist. But anyway. So this one was new. The one that I'm about to play. So in the end of the video you just watched, Donnie and I were like having a little conversation. And I wasn't sure if we should do it. And she gave me the nod, like, let's do it. And she's like, and I'm like, okay, we're doing it. And she's like, okay. Like, that's the conversation we were having. So, Blaine, awesome question. They're doing great. I love them. So, obviously, yeah. No, they're doing fine. I haven't spoken to Donnie in a while. It's been a while. But that'll change. Sooner or later, you know, we'll figure it out. Whatever it is. I just think we've been crossing paths in opposite directions. But I do talk to Paul and obviously Gary. And I did speak to Dave in, you didn't mention Dave, but I did speak to Dave in 2019, but I haven't spoken to him during the pandemic. Dying to, actually. I think I'm going to have to try to find Dave and give him a call. But yeah, no, everything's good. Man, if you only knew. I'm just joking, but exactly. Both are the same thing to me, Jack Mode. New Wave and Synth Pop are like one and the same to me. So I kind of lump it all together, you know? But I hesitate to call it pop music. Because true pop music, like what's out there right now or what was back then, I'm still not fond of it. I was never really, you know, I was never really a pop music fan, except for 60s pop. That kind of stuff I liked, but, you know. Anyway. Okay, let's see. Oh, yeah. This is going to be funny. This is a little longer, but it's funny.
We're taking a water break, just... Okay. All right, guys, are you ready to learn a song today? Yeah! Okay. They're ready, Claude. You want to teach them a song? All right. This is a new song for us, and we're going to try it here for the first time. It's called Life is Fun. And
I'm going to take Gary's mic. You guys gotta be the loudest. Repeat after me.
No, that's his side. That's his side.
Here, you can do it. You guys can cheat. No.
Look, Eric.
Okay, repeat after me. Everybody needs somebody.
Everybody loves somebody.
Everybody loves somebody.
Woo! Yeah.
There you go. Don't you know by now that life is fun?
Don't you know by now that life is fun?
Big shot.
life is fun.
We'll be right back.
I messed up. Sorry. I said it's hard to switch between videos that are outgoing and the screen that's incoming. So Jose asks, he doesn't know the history here, but he's asking, and it's a good question. How did we just get signed by Sony? Did you send demos to someone? How was the process? Honestly, Jose, this is how it works. Sending demos does absolutely nothing. Don't do it. It doesn't work. We got lucky because the DAT that we had wound up in a radio DJ's hands and he started playing it and it went bonkers. And everybody started calling to find out what song that was. And then other radio stations taped it off of each other. And then suddenly it was being played everywhere. That's how it happened. So then, as in now, you kind of have to start a ruckus on your own. And then you eventually will, you know, they'll come to you. If by the time you're doing really well, they'll come to you. But sending demos and like getting a demo tape and then someone suddenly deciding, I love this tape enough that I'm going to make, you know, this band tour and release all their records. Those days are long. They were already long gone by the time we came out. That was already ancient history. It wasn't even happening that way anymore. So radio was. David, you're good. Don't worry. You're good. You're going to be okay. I don't know that I can reserve them because I just minted all 368 of them. So they're gone. In other words, they exist. I don't know that I can take one back, but I'll figure that out. I'll figure that out because there might be a way, but I'll figure it out. So long as you have your wallet, that's all that's important. You'll understand why. I'm 48, but technologically I am 90. That's funny. That is really funny. You're going to be okay. It's all going to be good. Remember, you could always download it for free and just listen to it. That's the worst case scenario. The other stuff, I mean, you know. But it is worth trying. And for many reasons, some of which I can't even begin to explain to you why it's important. But let me put it to you this way. Unlike Kim Kardashian, who was caught in a scheme to get her fans to invest into crypto that was not legal and had to be fined by the SEC. This is a true story. You can look it up. I am trying to educate people into crypto with Tezos, which is a green currency. It is a real crypto used by banks and the good ones. And could change the way that art is bought and sold in the entire world. And it's green and it's friendly, eco-friendly, and you can use it as money. So while I'm not a financial advisor, I am going to say that I collect art on Tezos and I love to do it. And I probably will never stop. I just really love it. It's something I can't even explain. You'd have to be in it for a while. But, you know, so Jose says, do you think rock music is dead? No, but radio? I mean, radio is weird now, but radio was starting to get weird back in the 90s. So I don't know. I don't know that I miss radio because we have Sirius XM and Sirius XM is pretty darn good. I mean, that's as close as you can get to radio. But I do not like that there isn't a lot of stations, let's say, breaking new music. So the way that new music is broken is sort of insane right now. Twitter, social media, you know, Instagram. I don't know. It's a new world. Crypto is even breaking new music now. But, you know, at the same time, there are interesting things happening in these oddball spaces that none of us ever explored before. So there's new places to explore things. I think there's a lot more happening here than just crypto, you know, like I don't even know that I even like that word anymore. It's the future of money, good and bad. So I am trying desperately to get everyone on the good side of it, because the evil side is coming, and it's coming up, and it's coming up fast. And before you know it,